So I'm not sure I could cope with having it at 25 degrees myself,
it never hits 25. I just set it to 25. I think they're hottest 21.
If you've been following my channel over the last few weeks, then you'll know that I'm on the road to getting my old gas boiler replaced with an air source heat pump. I thought it might be a good idea to chat with someone who has already been through this process. So I'm going to be talking to Diarra today to find out what lessons he has learned after having a heat pump installed himself. Let's say hello to Diarra, who is here to tell us about his experience of having a heat pump installed. To give you all a bit of background here, Diarra's got a four-bedroomed detached property in the south of England. He had a gas boiler and ducted warm air heating, which is where there's air vents in most of the rooms. So it's actually quite an unusual heating system in the UK, so there were no radiators at all. And for hot water, he already had an insulated copper tank with an immersion heater in, so that was already electric only. So, hi Diarra, could you tell us about your new heating system, please, and what you replaced your gas boiler with, and maybe a bit about the new system design too?
Okay, so as you said, the old system was a hot air system, so a lot like the American systems, and that was trendy in the area that when they built the house. So that provided a lot of opportunity, but also a lot of problems. So because we didn't already have radiators. So because we didn't already have radiators downstairs, especially, we elected to go underfloor heating downstairs. So downstairs, it's all underfloor heated. The whole downstairs, and upstairs we install radiators, and we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 rooms upstairs, and they all have radiators in. So those are all driven by a Samsung 8.5 kilowatt air source heat pump. The hot water is provided by a SunAmp Heat battery, is what they call it. And I thought I'd go that way because it's more compact and, in theory, it's more efficient because it loses less heat.
So have you got, because a lot of the recommendations are for a single zone, but I think you've got two zones, haven't you?
I think I have like six zones, but technically. In terms of the heat pump and the hydronics, it's two zones, so upstairs, downstairs. So the heat pump will divert to one of those two zones. So it's two zones. Downstairs, there are three thermostats that will further split it into three zones. So they will call for heat depending on what temperature they are set at.
So I know I do have first-hand experience that your setup works well, because I've stayed in your spare room when I went to Fully Charged Live, and you set the temperature in there to 25 degrees. So I really know it works. It's not cold, I was sweltering. But how have you found the general heat levels in the house, and like especially with the underfloor heating downstairs? Has that been like a consistent heat? Has it worked well, or has it been too cold compared to the gas system before?
Yeah, so I think I generally am colder more. I feel the cold more easily in general, but I think the house is generally warmer than it was with the warm air system. So I think one of the things with an air system is that when the heating's on, you feel warm, but then when it's off, you feel cold. Whereas with the radiators and underfloor heating, you get a lot more consistent heat. So the house generally feels warmer than it did previously.
Did you have to make any other changes to your home at all, such as extra insulation, that sort of thing?
No, not really. So the loft was already insulated above the maximum recommended. We have cavity wall insulation, so there's not much more we can do with that. And the windows are all double glazed.
What about hot water then? So you said you had the SunAmp, which is interesting, because I know that we discussed this previously when you insisted that they're the future. I agree, but I'm not convinced they're quite ready for me yet. I'm planning on just a traditional hot water cylinder. Based on your experience, can you change my mind yet?
Well, I probably can't change your mind, because once your mind's set, it's set. I think the SunApp is a good system. So for those who don't know, it relies on a phase change technology. So it's, I think it's essentially sodium chloride or some sort of derivative of salt. Hence the reason why it's so heavy. But it heats the hot water flows through and indirectly heats that phase change material. And then when the material changes phase, it then stores that heat. And then it releases the water by cold water, it releases the heat by cold water running through the system, and then taking that heat. So because it's phase change, the system actually operates at a lower temperature. So it doesn't really go past 55, 60 degrees, whereas a hot water tank will go higher, store the water at a hotter temperature. And because of that, the actual heat loss from it is quite low, so it doesn't lose it. As compared to a hot water tank, it loses less heat than the well insulated hot water tank. So in theory, that's the reason that it's good to go with. It is more expensive, so 25 to 30% more expensive, I would say. I would definitely recommend it. The only mistake, if I had to do it differently, I'd probably get a bigger one. Because I got the one that says 140 liters and it's all right, but I think if you're having lots of showers or baths, then you need to charge multiple times a day, which is a issue if you have peak and off-peak tariffs.
In terms of running costs then, this is quite tricky to compare really, given the fluctuation in energy prices over the last couple of years, but do you have any sort of idea how it compares to running your old gas heating system over winter?
Well, it's difficult to compare because I have quite a few variables. So I don't just have a standard tariff, a flat tariff. I have Octopus Intelligent, which gives me off-peak pricing between 11:30 and 5:30. And also I have a battery. So I haven't logged how much of the energy I use comes from the off-peak tariff and how much comes from the peak tariff. But I've kind of did some rough calculations. And first of all, to say so, from the data from the heat pump itself, it's reporting that it's operating at a SCOP of between 3.9 December all the way to 4.4 in April, and that's including hot water and heating. So the running cost for hot water and heating for the last 5 months, so December, well, not last 5 months, from December to April, yes, my heating was on in April, don't judge me, is last, this winter gone was about £680, about, and the running cost the previous year, for the same period from my bills was £314. Obviously, gas prices increased, so if I was to do the same, if I was to use the same amount of gas as I did last year, it would come up to about £1,046. So according to these rough calculations, it's quite a lot cheaper. Even if my calculations are off and I've kind of underestimated it, it's still gonna be cheaper, or at least no more expensive than if I had gas.
Well, that's quite good then, that it's potentially saving money. I'm not sure I'm gonna save any money when I get mine installed, because I was using a lot less gas than you did. So I guess there'll be another video this time next year of you interviewing me, asking me whether I regret the decision or not, but we'll see. So now onto the company who installed this for you then. How did you go about choosing a company?
I looked online, I looked on Check a Trade, I looked at MCS. So I got two or three estimates. The company, so I think obviously you have to be MCS certified, so that ruled out one company right away, and they actually ruled themselves out. Having said you can get a company who isn't MCS certified, but you just can't claim the government rebate, which is a lot. So I ruled out two companies, and then one company was quite a lot cheaper. Especially as I had quite a lot of work through, needed to radiators and underfloor heating, etc. So it was quite a lot cheaper. So I actually went for the cheaper of the two companies. I was reassured by the fact that they were MCS certified, because I thought, apparently you have to jump through a lot of hoops to get MCS certified. So I thought that was a big thing. The advice I would give you is that is just one part of the story. So in retrospect, I think from my opinion, the company didn't have a lot of heat pump experience. So you could tell that some things were new to them. So they hadn't really installed any sun amps before. They're not big on hydronics and system design. They just kind of designed it as they would similarly design a normal gas boiler system, and a few things they didn't know about. So it was quite a difficult process. In the end, the system works. Apart from the stress of installing it, the COPs on the system are supposedly good. So I think in the end, it's all right. Would I recommend that specific company? Probably not, but it was a lot cheaper. So
I think you've kind of rolled into my final question, because I said, well, we're not going to name the company in question, but if you were to do this again, what would you do differently? Would you get more quotes, maybe spend more with a different company? You've already said you probably wouldn't recommend the company you've used, so I guess that means you wouldn't use the same ones again. But is there anything that you would do differently about the whole system, really?
Yeah, I don't know if I would use the same company, but as I said, it was a lot cheaper. So I think it probably, even if the system is rubbish designed and I'm spending a lot of extra money in paying heating because the system is poorly designed, it will take a decade plus to recoup the difference in price. So I probably would go maybe get a third company, and you know, maybe you had a bit more experience to pay a little bit more for them. So I guess the price I paid for getting the cheapest company was that I had quite a lot more stress. And also, I guess one thing to say is that my systems is a bit different in that, not different, the way I run my system's different, because I actually, you said I had the heating set to 25. I do set it to 25, but that's not 25 throughout the day. I set it at a high temperature so that it comes on at off-peak time and stays on at off-peak time. So it's not ready to get it. So because I have the underfloor heating, I try to use that as a thermal mass to during the nighttime when it's off-peak, fill that thermal mass so that I have to run the heat pump less during the day.
Because you're doing that for a money-saving thing, right? Yeah. So you put it at 25 in the night, so as it builds up heat, and then that can drop a bit when, and sort of stay at a reasonable level during the peak energy times. I gotta say, I can understand why you want to save money, but I think I also enjoy sleeping, so I'm not sure I could cope with having it at 25 degrees myself.
It never hits 25. I just set it to 25. I think they're hottest 21. Did it?
It was 25. I got up at about 3 a.m. and it was 25 degrees in that room. That room that you're in right now, actually.
This is, to be fair, this is the warmest room because it is north facing, so it gets whatever sun in the afternoon. So in the afternoon, it's warmer, and the heating, the radiator here is massive, and it's a relatively small room. So this is the hottest room. So
I wanted to open the window, but I couldn't reach it.
Unlucky you. But yeah, so I mean, I think so. The house is warm when you wake up, and I guess that's a balance. But I trade that off having a slightly hotter house in the morning, so I have to run the heat pump less during the day when it's peak time. Because I do, and the other thing is I have batteries, so I have 16 kilowatt hours worth of battery storage. So I can run that during the day and let the heat pump pull from that. Actually, some days I will burn through the whole battery. So some winter days I use 50 kilowatt hours in a day. So I will easily burn through the battery capacity. So I really do, I'm trying to avoid that, because then I have to pay peak, which is about five times the price of the off-peak tariff.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your time and for sharing your heat pump installation experience with us. If you found this video useful, then please give it a like and don't forget to subscribe to see more videos from me. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.